Ladies, do you sometimes wonder if you're called to leadership? Do you sometimes wonder why should you even learn about leadership if you're not in a leadership role? Well, leadership is for everyone, whether it be at home, community, church. And today we have a great presentation, The Commandments of Leadership. And I am thrilled to have our speaker today. I am Gail Davis with the Endless Mountains Empowerment Summit for Women, bringing you 21 days of virtual empowerment. Today, our speaker is Linda Lathrop, and I love Linda. We've known each other for a few years. She was a keynote speaker last year at our Empowerment Summit, one of our breakout session speakers. And she today is going to be talking about the basic commandments of leadership, of becoming an effective leader. Linda has served in many leadership roles, District 65, which is Central New York State leadership. She's been Toastmaster, governor. She's had every role imaginable. She owns her own business, Lathrop Consulting. She serves many boards. Linda is an expert extraordinaire, and I can't wait to hear what she has to say. So Linda, I'm turning it all over to you. Teach me about leadership. Give me the basic commandments. Help me.
All right. Well, good morning, and thank you for inviting me to speak, to share perhaps some of the thoughts that I have about leadership, to know that I'm not the expert. I dabble. I make mistakes. I learn, hopefully, from each mistake, and I keep moving forward. I think we probably always have heard the question, are leaders born or are leaders made? Have you heard that, Gail?
Oh, I would love to find out. Please help me.
Well, you know, that just has been a common question in many of the leadership groups that I have facilitated. In a variety of literature, you see that question a lot. And you actually see, you know, people are born into leadership, kings and queens and princes and families who have political folks that come from their particular family line. People just have this thing that they're born into, and they're a natural leader. And then there's others that say, oh, wait, it's only when there's a catastrophe, when there's a challenge, when there's something that happens that somebody needs to step up, does that person become a leader? And so perhaps they are not natural leaders, but they have that ability to say, yes, send me. Mm-hmm. I'm guilty of that a lot. I didn't learn that. I didn't come born with that skill. And I don't believe that either you've got it or you don't. I believe everyone can take some steps, can figure out how to be a leader. So I grew up in a family that was one of those children are seen but not heard families. Mm-hmm. And probably a lot of folks have had that as well. You know, you knew that you just didn't barge into conversations. You didn't have a whole lot of ideas that you shared. But I learned really early, man, if I sat in a corner and I just listened to those adults, I could learn all kinds of things. I could learn what they were thinking. I could learn probably how they were going to make decisions. And I could take that all in, which I did. I used to think that my greatest skill was listening. I didn't think that I had other skills. But then sometimes you reach a point where you come to either a workplace situation or a personal situation, a community situation, where somebody has to step up and say, okay, I can be in charge of that. I will figure it out. If you think you can help me, come along. That's really what that's what a leader is. They have that ability to get people to come along with them. And they have that ability to have folks also stand up and say, yes, I'll do that. So today I run into the opposite problem of I have to be very careful not to volunteer to take charge of things at a meeting. I sometimes have to sit on my hands so that I don't raise that hand and say, yes, I'll do that. I have to stop and think, perhaps giving someone else an opportunity to step up, to learn what they need to know. So I think that leadership is really kind of an odd thing because almost everyone thinks that he or she knows what it is Somehow we all think we're good at it, and rarely do we think we perhaps need some basic ideas or thoughts as to what would make us more effective. So that's the basic premise. I think that everyone is a leader, as I said, whether it be moms and dads in their families. Friends lead friends. Sometimes friends lead friends into trouble. Sometimes friends lead people onward to greater things. And obviously in businesses and organizations, there are leaders. So I believe also that if you want to or you need to badly enough, that you can learn what you need to do. I have a great definition of leadership that I look at often, and it simply says to me, leadership is the process by which the leader influences the thoughts and actions of others toward the achievement of a mutual goal. And often we just really don't have that in mind when we think about, you know, what is that mutual goal?
I like that, Linda, because your goal may not be their goal.
Exactly, exactly. And sometimes it's figuring out what is that joint goal, and then how do we get there together? Those are very, very important things, I believe. I think the worst thing is to say, you know, it's my goal. Just come along and do what I tell you to do. That's not really leadership.
And I think one of the reasons why the Endless Mountains Empowerment has been so effective is because we've got an advisory team of leaders with the same mission and purpose and goal in mind to empower, inspire, and educate women of our region in personal growth and professional development.
Yeah, and that's what makes it exciting and why people want to be involved. It actually is what encouraged me to say, yes, I'd like to do this again, or I'd like to do a small part of it. Those things are that visionary piece that pulls people together, going in the same direction. Those are really good. So here's some factors that form the foundation of leadership. And I think of this, we know these things, we just never think about them. So let's just think about them a minute. First of all, something needs to be done. No one person can do the entire task. And then there are others that are interested in helping you get the task done. But you as the leader take the responsibility for accomplishing the task with these other people. And you do that by harnessing the combined efforts of everyone for success. So those are very basic things in terms of how do we get that done. And I hope that makes sense. I'll try to
it does. Thank you.
Format for the audience so that you can share that with them. Years ago in my small community that I lived in for a lot of years, we began a small ambulance, emergency medical services organization. Reason being that we were at least 35, 40 minutes from medical help should we need it. And I lived in a home where most of the accidents at that time were right in front of my house. Just happened to be an odd stretch of road. People would get a little carried away with their speed or not paying attention. And often there were accidents right there. Nothing is more frustrating than not being able to get the help you need for people. So the community got together. IBM actually gave us a grant, and we bought a $2,000 old Cadillac ambulance. It looked like a hearse, except it was painted red and white. And it had a light and a siren and all of those things. You couldn't stand up in it to take care of a patient. You basically did all patient care kind of on your knees, that type of thing. And so many of us went to, and at that time in Pennsylvania, you only had to have advanced first aid and a CPR card to render care. And so we formed this organization, and we didn't have a place to store the ambulance. So we stored the ambulance in the garage at my house. It makes a lot of sense because if the accidents are always right there, just do that. But what I learned early on is that even going from my house to another location with a group of people, a team of people in an ambulance, somebody has to be the leader. Somebody has to be in charge. And granted, in that situation, you've got, you know that something needs to be done. You know that not just one person can do the task. And usually in a small community, there's others that are interested in helping. Somebody has to take responsibility for accomplishing the task. And it takes all of the efforts from that group of people to get it done. So interestingly enough, what would happen on an ambulance call would be, there might be three or possibly four of us that would respond, a driver and some trained people. And we'd race to the scene, and that's exciting. Lights and sirens and lots of adrenaline flowing. And get to the scene, and then people would tend to look at each other and be like, so who's going to go into the house? Who's going to check the patient? And very early on, I thought, well, this is just silly. May as well be me because nobody else is making a move. And sure enough, what happens in that situation is when one person is bold enough to take the lead, other people follow along and get the job done. So I think that's one of my greatest lessons in leadership is just step out, take that time to say, oh, I can do this. I might not be perfect, but I can take a stab at it. I can try to figure it out. And when that group of people comes along with you, that is really wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. So that's probably my only real story about leadership that I feel like I just always think I learned so much from that experience that allowed me to have confidence in doing other things. I also like this quote from John Seaman Gams, and he says, real leaders are ordinary people with extraordinary determinations.
Oh, I like that.
And I'm going to say that again because you do like that. But isn't that a good one? It's really a good one. Real leaders are ordinary people with extraordinary determinations. That's John Seaman Gams. So leadership is not about being in charge. It's about making a difference. It's about achievement. It's about having other people follow. And I think this is also really important. No one is a leader unless they have followers. That's something we just sort of miss. We miss, how do you do that? Do you know what it takes? So I've had the opportunity to have a presenter in some of my leadership programs who does a short piece on the 10 commandments of leadership. And I began to play around with those just to make them more personal, which I think is what people need to do. I'm not going to share all of hers because I think they are personal to her. But in thinking of what it takes to become an effective leader, and by that I mean a leader that not only attracts people, but actually makes things happen. Mm-hmm. What is it that it takes? And I think that, first of all, we need to become aware of who we are. So I would challenge everyone who's listening to think about, who am I? Not just who you are that people see, but who are you on the inside? What makes you tick? Why do you do things? And then by doing that, you become the leader that you want to be on the outside.
Well, Linda, it's so funny that you say that because one of our gift offerings for all the women that access endlessmountainsempowerment.weebly.com is an ebook that I created on knowing your why.
Yeah.
On knowing your why, life purpose discovery, who are you? So I think this is a perfect segue. We did not plan this out. This is an infomercial for a free ebook. So perfect.
But I think that is so important because, I mean, obviously each of us are a little bit different on the inside. What motivates us and what causes us to do certain things. Take on a cause, for instance, or in my case, to become a district leader for Toastmasters. And I only did that because somebody said, why don't you? I'd like to nominate you, why don't you? And so that became one of those, okay, maybe I could do that. I could probably do that. And then you kind of get hooked on leadership in that aspect as well. So this is what I have listed as I think are some of the most important or basic commandments to be an effective leader. This is what I would put on or have on my list. That number one, that character is the core of leadership. So I need to be more concerned about my character than my reputation. Reputation is simply what other people think, but character is who I am or who you are. And often we face challenges that require making a choice between character and compromise. So if that basic core, if I know who I am, if I know my why, then I'm going to make the decision based on that and probably not always be saying, well, maybe we could compromise on this issue. Knowing sometimes we have to, but I need to know the basics. Where am I in the very beginning? Well, the second thing is that we need to be committed to whatever it is we choose to do. So I believe that commitment starts in the heart. That's the core of who I am and why I do things. So it starts in the heart. And that's what inspires and attracts others, is that sort of people will say, well, that's a heartfelt statement. That's a heartfelt thought. Or I'm going to go along with this because I can feel you're in the heart of the matter is, this is in the heart. So I think that when we have a cause and we're committed to it and we know our why, that allows us to be committed. So that became my number two. And number three would be to listen more than you speak. That's the lesson I learned when I was really little. Children should be seen and not heard. It doesn't mean you can't learn from it, but to listen. And when we listen to people, we can absolutely begin to have a greater understanding of who they are, what their needs are, perhaps even what their skills are, sometimes identifying a skill that they didn't even know they had themselves. But I believe it comes from the listening, and that people believe in a person who listens actually probably more so than they do the cause, because they say, oh, you know, I'm important. I have a part in this.
Linda, with listening, some of the things that I think about is, it's okay to ask a question when you're listening. It's okay to say, tell me more.
Absolutely.
Help me understand this. I want to understand what's making you tick. And then let the person speak. But it's okay to clarify. So when I think of listening, I think of just sitting still and saying nothing. But listening can be active too.
Right.
That help me understand more.
Absolutely. And I think that's the part that often we don't understand. Is that we may have that question of, gee, I think I get it, but
I'm a little confused.
If you give me just a little bit more information, perhaps I can make a better decision. But to really make sure that what the words that are being said are actually and conveyed, and is that exactly what they mean? Mm-hmm. I tend to talk around things, as you can well see. Sometimes my greatest decision-making comes when I'm talking around things. And I'll hear myself say something and I'll think, oh, yes, that's it. Or that was the missing piece. Why couldn't I think about that? So for listening and in listening to others, I believe it's a part of asking that pertinent question, asking for clarification. Or simply rephrasing and saying, well, this is what I think I heard you say.
I love that. This is what I think I heard you say. And they can at that point say, no, you're totally off.
Way off.
Really, really. Or yes, you've got it.
Exactly. Exactly. Because that is the missing piece often when we're communicating. We just assume that people understand all of those words. I know that I sometimes don't understand any of the words. I have to take myself away sometimes and get quiet and really think about what was said before I have a response that is worthwhile. that makes sense. So I think that people follow, or they want to follow someone that they can understand. And they do want to follow someone who listens. So, and again, going back to actions and character and being consistent, your words have to be a part of that, and your actions have to reflect that consistency. You can't say one thing and do another. You must be clear, but that thoughtful listening is such a big part of it. And sometimes it's tiring. Those of us who listen get really tired. Sometimes I get physically really tired. I'm like, oh, I can't listen anymore. I need to shut that off for a while. So I think that, you know, listening becomes sort of that, if I were gonna categorize or prioritize, I might move it way up high, but I kind of like it right there about number three, number four, sort of after commitment and after character, and then thinking about the listening piece of it. Number four I have down as being the best of who you are. Bring the best of who you are into everything you do.
So it's so funny you say that, because some of the speakers for empowerment are basically teaching how to become a better version of yourself, or the best version of yourself.
Exactly. But I think that's something we aren't often aware of that, or we don't consciously say, today, I'm going to bring my best. I'm going to try to do everything that I have to do today with excellence.
I like that.
I'm going to show up. Mm-hmm. I'm going to keep improving. Mm-hmm. We had talked earlier about books that we've read and how often we go back and reread books. And maybe we look at the notes we put in the margins, or what did we highlight? And then we look at how did that impact us, and how is it impacting us now? What's that new message that we're gaining from that? And I think that's a part of learning and being the best at what you do, is that every day you keep setting the bar higher, and you just maybe set a goal to be just a little bit better every day. Sometimes we set goals that are too big. And perhaps we should think about, what's that one thing today that will make me better at what I do? How do I do that? And consciously, at the end of the day, being able to say, did I practice that? Did I do that? How do you challenge yourself to be or bring the best of who you are into everything that you do? I think that that's very key. And then number five I have down is certainly even two, and I think this goes back to my ambulance story, is to step forward in a bold way and be brave even in the face of fear.
I think of the book by John Maxwell, Failing Forward.
Absolutely, absolutely.
That it's okay to fail, but you're stepping forward, you're moving, and you're doing it. Because if you don't, you'll never succeed. Right. And how will you never know? But the greatest leaders are those that have failed the most times. I think of Thomas Edison. Mm-hmm. How many times did he try to design the light bulb? Over 1,000.
Over 1,000, yeah. That's the ones we know about, probably.
Right. So step forward. Excellent. Be brave.
And sometimes I think that's a piece of two steps forward and one step back. Two mm-hmm. steps forward and one step back.
But no, you're moving forward.
Always moving forward. Those are key. Just in thinking about that. So step forward in a bold way. Mm-hmm. You don't do that quietly. You make that decision and you just try to be brave. Mm-hmm. Fear usually goes away once we make that step. I think of that in many instances. If you were to do a talk about just fear, you know, what fears have you faced and how did you get beyond them? Most of us would find that if we were brave and we just tried it, things get better. We absolutely get better. I have number six is to stand by your convictions, which simply to me means walk your talk. So strong convictions precede great actions. And it's our convictions that cause us to act with integrity. I've got to know where I stand. What's truth for me? What's important for me? That's how
it goes back to who you are and your core values.
It goes back
to what's important to you.
Absolutely. And it's also how you act and what you say and how you treat others. Mm-hmm. So, and that conviction or that walk the talk, who you are, is actually, I think it's a piece of how you build trust. Others trust you if they know that what you say you are going to do, you will do. So that is all a piece of standing by your convictions. You can't tell one person one thing and the next 2 days tell somebody else a different piece. It just doesn't work.
Or do as I say, not as I do.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think that's always to be really important. Currently, I'm serving Toastmasters in Central and Western New York as the program quality director. And a part of that is to focus on excellence. And oftentimes, we don't think about that enough either. You know, what makes this an excellent talk? Mm-hmm. What makes this an excellent product? What makes this worth my time in listening? And I think we need to always step back a little bit, sort of take a moment to really think about that, then evaluate and set some priorities and think about how do I do what I do with consistent excellence. I actually like that term, consistent excellence. It's not just being excellent for a minute or a moment, but it's about how, it's part of that also, how do I get better every day? But how do I be consistently excellent? Awareness, and again, going back to why and who I am and what do I do, it's all a part of that. That in turn leads me to what I consider to be number eight, is to be clear in my vision, to have a clear sense of my mission, my vision, my purpose, and how it'll draw others to me. And then two, to know how well I know when I'm successful.
Mm. So some sort of measure.
I think we have to measure that. Often I know, I see things sometimes way at a distance. I'm not always clear in how I communicate that. Mm. But sometimes that, going back to the communication piece, is to really getting others then to explain, so what do you see? How do you see it? But knowing that clear vision and then having a measurement, how do I measure that? Whether it's just a simple scale of 1 through 5, was I clear today? Did everybody I talked to understand? Can I ask them that? How did we do today? How do you think we could do this better? Those are very key pieces in vision and being clear. Some days vision, I believe, is easier than others.
Linda, I like those questions that you were sharing. How can I do this? How can I? Yeah. So I'm assuming this, as a leader, you have a team. There's people Absolutely. That you can pull Absolutely. In and really engage them. Because I find that when I engage my teams, mm-hmm. I see things from a totally different perspective.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I totally agree with that. And I think we don't often take the time to ask for that feedback, that evaluation, or, you know, how are we really doing? Let's just be honest and talk about how do you see this? What is it that we could add on? What is it we could take away?
Or what am I missing?
Yeah. You know, all of those really great questions. I probably, some of the basic ways to be an effective leader is to really know or have a list of great questions to evaluate, to consistently be better. So I think those are just super important. And then obviously number nine for me is always to seek knowledge and wisdom. I don't know how you feel about that, but I just think, you know, seeking knowledge and wisdom. I'm a reader and I get a lot of my knowledge from reading books, but I gain a lot of wisdom from listening to other people.
It's funny that you say you're a reader. I'm reading a book right now, High Performance Habits, How Extraordinary People Become That Way by Brendon Burchard. So leaders are readers.
Absolutely.
That if you want to lead a team, if you feel that you're called to this, even moms, to read.
Absolutely.
Because seek knowledge and wisdom. It's so vital.
It is really vital. And I think that, again, just how do you do that? I mean, obviously, in this day and age, you can listen to podcasts. I listened to a good one yesterday with Michael Hyatt, and it was a great podcast. But again, that's another way of taking in information and saying, how am I going to use that? Is that valuable? Can I put that into practice? So there's a lot of ways to gain knowledge and wisdom, but also to be very intentional about it. Have perhaps 15 minutes a day to read something different. Doesn't hurt. In one of the leadership programs I do, I require my participants that all come from different businesses to read a book about leadership. I don't give them a lot of or a list of books I want them to read. I simply say to them, do some research, find a book that you think you would like to read that has hopefully a leadership lesson in it. And it doesn't have to be a great lot of pages. It could be something really small. But what I want you to do is to read it. I want you, or to listen to it. I want you to take that information and I want you to think about what is the leadership lesson in this book. And then I want you to think about how you might use it. And eventually I want you to come back to our group and I want you to share the book you read, why you chose it, what you learned, and would you recommend it to somebody else? And guess what? It's okay to say, I don't recommend this book, because at least you learned something. And that is a proven to be an exercise that people resist at first. Many people resist. Last year in my program, I had a gentleman who, after I suggested a John C. Maxwell book. I'm not sure which one I suggested. I said, it's little short things. You'll be able to read just a little bit. And he came back to me and he said, oh my gosh. He said, I hadn't read a book since college.
Oh my goodness.
He'd been working in the workplace a lot of years. He just had chosen not to read any more books. He said, I forgot. And you don't have to read for a long period of time. You can read a little bit and look for a lesson. And guess what? He said to me, so what should I read next? And for me, that moment of saying, oh, I'm a success because I got him to read a book. Now he wants to read again to learn more. So I would encourage people to take, just a look at an article about not necessarily leadership, but something that appeals to you. You mentioned families and people within their families. There might be something that is a short story or something that will just give you a little bit of uplift. Something that'll give you a little more information. Might be how to organize things better. It might be how to be in charge. It may be how to let other people be in charge. Sometimes we have to help people learn to be followers, or we need to ask them to let us be a follower for a while. But reading and lifelong learning and seeking knowledge and wisdom, I think are really, really key. They can help you survive competition. They can help us all manage change if we're really looking for how to do that. They can help us learn to improve ourselves. They can help us to help our team members improve themselves. So together as a whole, everybody is better. And I think the real lesson in that is to seek knowledge and wisdom, but stay open, stay curious, stay teachable, looking for ideas and opportunities. And in my case, I always use the word possibilities because I think all things are possible. But I think that's really key. And finally, well, actually, I have a bonus after number 10. So I think I'm just going to do that. So I think number 10 is to always try to build and strengthen relationships with others and practice connecting with people. And that might be a good day-to-day activity. How do I connect? Is it by an email? Is it by a text message? Mm-hmm. Is it by a telephone call? Mm-hmm. And perhaps in the case of social distancing, is it across a back fence? Something that, I still am able to connect with people. And then when we're connecting with people or our team members, is to acknowledge what they contribute. For instance, with you, Gail, your contribution of facilitating or organizing 21 Days of Empowerment as a plan C, I believe. How did that happen? But that piece of strengthening relationships with others, that's really key in terms of doing that. But you always acknowledge the contributions of others. I think that's who you are. You're very
Thank
gifted
you.
in doing that. And for me, sometimes that's hard. I'm easy. I it's easier for me to accept the blame than it is to acknowledge the contributions of others for some reason. It might just be a quirky thing with me. But giving credit for your team when things go right. Those I sometimes you see people that do that, and you see their team members around them. And you almost see them kind of swelling up. Like, look at us, we did that. The leader acknowledged that, and then how do we do that? And again,
I had a good example, a leader that I know through another business I'm associated with. Oh my goodness, the kudos that she gives everybody, whether it be little certificates or plaques or trophies, but she's always acknowledging your contribution.
right.
And it then makes you believe I can do it. I can
Absolutely.
do it. Yes,
Absolutely.
someone believes in me. I can do it.
And it's interesting because sometimes it's just that it's that acknowledgement even more so than the little gift or the little trophy, but it all goes together. It all has its place. So remember that obviously you have to have followers to be a leader. We talked about that earlier, but you got to take care of those people. And then you've got to celebrate. Celebrate those successes and learn from the failures and go on again, keep doing it. But most of all, I think this is probably the biggest piece, and it sort of fell into my lap in terms of a commandment if I were to think about basics. That's why I thought 10 wasn't enough, is to remain optimistic.
Oh, I like that. Okay.
And I would encourage anyone who's listening to follow not my commandments, but write down your own. Figure out what makes some commandments that are basic to who you are and who you want to be and who you want to be as a leader. Make some of your own. Be optimistic, and then I believe you'll find that there isn't much that you cannot do. But the optimism is a very key piece in terms of this is who I want to be as a leader. These are my basic commandments. So make some of yours, maintain optimism, and I would simply say go forward and take every opportunity to lead that you can possibly take.
Linda, this has been wonderful. I'm just so excited. I can't wait to re-look over these notes and also design my own 10 commandments of leadership.
Yeah, that's really what I want people to do. I want them to think about what's unique to them and what's important. Thank you for the opportunity. I so appreciate it.
Oh, we are blessed by you. Thank you, Linda.
You're
Thank you.
welcome.
And we're looking forward to seeing you again, hopefully at next year's Empowerment Summit.
I hope so too. It's always such a wonderful opportunity for folks to participate and be involved as even the attendees. That's a wonderful, wonderful opportunity. Next year will be personal and better in person, correct?
It will. It
Yeah,
will. Thank you so much, Linda. Thank you.